Chapter number 2 of Linear Integrated Circuits, Ideal Operational Amplifier Analysis and Design. In this chapter, we're going to look at the operational amplifier from an idealistic point of view, that is, how the operation of linear operational amplifier, how a linear operational amplifier works in an ideal situation. Now, as you will see in chapter number 3 and chapter number 4, that these ideal situations actually are pretty practical. And under most circumstances, when we analyze operational amplifier, we consider ideal situation. Because, as I say, that these conditions will be very close to the actual practical conditions when you apply those conditions, and there is not much difference. However, as far as a simplification of the analysis is concerned, considering operational amplifier as an ideal operational amplifier and doing the analysis is much simpler than going back and consider operational amplifier to be under a practical situation or under non-ideal condition. So whatever we are learning in this chapter, it is going to be extremely important for rest of the chapters. So I have some of the introduction over here that you can go over when the ideal when the operational amplifier was created back in 1940s by Bell Laboratories. But the real applications of operational amplifier didn't start until 1960s. And now operational amplifier, of course, is one of the most commonly used integrated circuit in all the electronics, pretty much all the electronics. The original operational amplifier that was created by Fairchild Semiconductor, or rather the one that was made popular by Fairchild Semiconductors, was 741. Mu A is a special designation for Fairchild, but 741 is the operational amplifier which is still the most commonly used operational amplifier, and the one that you are going to be using in the simulation for the labs, and of course if we would be doing the labs hands-on, and hopefully we will do the labs hands-on in the future, then we use 741 as our basic operational amplifier on the breadboard as well. Some of the basic characteristics of 741 are given here. Usually it is used at low frequencies, not more than 1 megahertz, but generally there are operational amplifiers that can go up to 15 megahertz or so. Data sheet of 741 is in the book and widely available online, so make sure to study those data sheet for the important characteristics of 741. 741 internal circuit diagram, as you can see, is this, and you can see that there are a bunch of different transistors, some Darlington pair transistor like this, and bunch of different resistors, some capacitors and stuff. Let me make it a little. Okay. The IC, the commonly used IC, is an 8-pin IC, and in that 8-pin IC there are some pins that you don't use. For example, pin number 8 is not a connection. Generally we do not use pin number 5 and pin number 1. So this is pin number 5, offset null, pin number 1. The pins that are most commonly used are the input pins. Operational amplifier is a differential amplifier, that is, it basically magnifies or amplifies the voltage difference that is applied between the positive input, which is called non-inverting input, and the negative input, which is called inverting input. So pin number 2, as you can see over here, is inverting input, and pin number 3 is non-inverting input. So in your simulations, basically, of course, you're not going to be using IC. You're going to be using something like this with the bisync pins. So you're going to be using V positive non-inverting input terminal, V negative inverting input terminal. And VD is the voltage differential between positive and negative inputs. So at the output, in general, if we use operational amplifier in the open circuit configuration, then or open loop configuration, then at the output, this voltage is amplified. This voltage is multiplied by the amplification factor of the op amp, and the output is created. So output is important, input pins are important, and each operational amplifier 741 specifically, you have to bias the amplifier, that is, you have to give the DC power to the amplifier using the positive DC source and the negative DC source, which on the IC are pin number 7 and pin number 4. And on the the internal circuit diagram, you can see that this is the negative what we call negative VCC or negative power, DC power, and positive DC power. Now remember, these two are different than the input. Usually at the input you give AC signals, and these are DC signal. Remember, every amplifier that you use, they require some sort of DC signal to boost the voltage or boost the current or boost the power based on what type of amplifier you're using. No circuit can generate extra amount of voltage, current, or power without the help of any voltage source. Of course, you need some power to increase the power, input power. It cannot get increased by itself. So every amplifier requires some sort of DC biasing, what we call DC biasing or DC input. So operational amplifier is the same. Basically, it requires positive input, positive DC power, and negative DC power. And those two pins are generally over here. Right here, if I want to show the complete model, then basically this is your positive or negative. One is negative VCC and one is positive VCC, whichever is where. So negative VCC and positive VCC. So the way you connect, if it is negative or positive, whichever is that, then you just go ahead and you connect it with the source. This will be grounded, and then you have another source. That's going to be positive over here. Okay, so that's going to be your, let's say, the most common voltage source we use is 15 volt and negative 15 volts. So this is a 15 volt source, and this is also a 15 volt source. But since this is positive side with respect to the ground, it is going to be positive VCC. And then this is negative side with respect to ground. So over here, the voltage is going to be negative 15, because the voltage difference between the positive side and negative side is 15 volt. So this side will have negative 15 volt with respect to ground, and that will be connected to negative VCC. So that's how you're going to connect actually in the lab simulation as well. Okay. So as I mentioned, it's a differential amplifier. It amplifies the difference of the two inputs in non-inverting minus inverting at the output. And we discussed the positive VCC and negative VCC. So go over that. I don't have to read everything. Some of the application of operational amplifier is used pretty much everywhere. Audio amplifier, regulators, active filters. We're gonna study active filters. Medical applications are a lot. So oscillators, comparators. We're going to study oscillators, we're going to study comparators, signal generators, we're going to study hearing aids. I mean, the applications are pretty much unlimited applications. Whichever device you pick up, there's a good chance that there's an operational amplifier in there. So how do we consider the operational amplifier model? As we discussed in chapter number 1, it's a voltage controlled voltage device. The voltage that appears between the input over here, which is VD, is amplified. So this is the voltage right here, VD between positive and negative. And this is basically V input is VD right here. And this voltage is amplified by A, which is called the open loop or open circuit voltage gain of the amplifiers. Soon the circuits that we will study are closed loop circuit. So the gain of the closed loop circuit will be called closed loop gain, and A is called the open loop gain. So A multiplied by Vp minus Vn, which is the voltage differential. And of course, this is the output resistance, which is extremely small. R1 is the input resistance, or R input is the input resistance, which is extremely large. And the output voltage of the operational amplifier. So whatever current is coming out, some voltage is going to be drop in R out, and the output is going to be A Vp minus Vn minus the voltage drop here. That's going to be at the output. Now, under ideal condition, we assume R naught to be approximately zero. And we assume R in to be approximately infinity. Very, very large. So those two are ideal assumption. And as you will see when we discuss chapter number 3 and chapter number 4, that these ideal assumption are valid even for practical purpose. There's not much difference if you don't assume ideal conditions, you will still get very close result as the ideal condition result. Also, we assume ideally open loop gain A is also infinity, very large. Practically, it's not, it's I think 200,000 or something as we're gonna study, or 20,000, I forgot. But it's when we study chapter 3 and 4, then you will see the practical value of A. But under ideal condition, we assume it is extremely, extremely large. So, in general, under ideal assumption, input resistance is infinity, so we show it as an open circuit. Output resistance is zero, we show it as a short circuit, and the output voltage of the operational amplifier is the same as AVD, because again, no voltage is dropped in the output resistance. Now, one extremely important result for the ideal case, which again will be valid for pretty much all of our under all of our situations, and that result is right here. Oops, I should not be making this mark, but anyways. So that result is right over here. Let me erase this thing. Okay. So as you can see over here, A V plus minus V negative, V positive of course is the non-inverting input, V negative is the inverting input, times A, that's the output, right, from this output. Now, we know that A is extremely large, almost infinity. So V positive minus V negative is output over A, and A is almost infinity, that means this is going to be zero. So V positive minus V negative, ideally, is zero. Which means that whatever voltage is there on the non-inverting input, you're gonna see the same voltage as the at the inverting input. And that's an extremely important result when you are solving the circuits, the operational amplifier circuit under ideal condition. So keep this in mind. We're gonna be using this assumption pretty much in every circuit that we are going to solve. Okay, this is not, this is not, I'm gonna fix this. Okay, so again, to reiterate, V positive is V negative, and since input resistance is infinity under ideal condition, hence no current flows in the input terminals. So the current I negative, what we call the current that is flowing in the input terminal right here, why it is doing that, but any case. So this current I negative and this current I positive both will be assumed to be zero under ideal condition. Okay. So these are some ideal condition that we're gonna be using. No current flows into the terminals and positive input is equal to the negative input. Now, we don't really use operational amplifier under there is specific application under which we use operational amplifier in the open loop configuration, but for majority of the application, operational amplifier is not used in the open loop configuration. That is, operational amplifier is not used in this condition or this condition, such that you just connect the input and measure the output. Why? Because remember, the gain is extremely large, infinity. So any slightly different input between V positive and V negative, if VD is like microvolt or nanovolt, let's say, since gain is infinity, what's going to happen at the output? The output is just going to shoot, and the output cannot go beyond the value of VCC, whatever the value of VCC is, positive, negative 15 in this case. So output cannot go beyond that value. So what's going to happen is the output is going to saturate. So as soon as you apply a tiny bit of voltage difference, you create a tiny bit of voltage here, what's going to happen at the output? That the output is just going to become a square wave like this, because it's going to saturate. And usually the saturation limits are, theoretically we can assume it's 15 and negative 15, but practically it's less than 15, and generally we assume it's about 13 volt that it will saturate. So basically it's not going to go beyond 13 volt. As soon as it will hit 13 volt, then if you increase the voltage a little bit at the input, it's just going to become flatter and flatter, and it's going to become pretty much a square wave eventually. And that's called the saturation of the output. So if you use the operational amplifier in the open loop condition, then basically it's pretty much useless, because the output will always be saturated and it's going to be always be a square wave. Now there are circuits that we're going to study, like the oscillators and stuff, in which we desired this output. So some of those circuits are used in the open loop configuration, as we're going to study. But general circuits, they are not, we don't create general circuit in the open loop configuration. Okay, so next video we're going to discuss inverting amplifier.